Welcome all to this town hall meeting hosted by ARREST, the Association for Responsible and Environmentally Sustainable Sewage Treatment. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Dr. Sean Peck, and I will be your facilitator today. I'll tell you what the agenda we have in mind for you. First of all, I will spend a few minutes talking about the history of the Victoria sewage treatment issue and make some comments on the public health aspects. Secondly, Brian Birchall, a member of ARREST, will give us a presentation on the issue and why ARREST is so passionate about the campaign to stop the present bad plan for land-based sewage treatment for Victoria. Thirdly, I will then introduce David Anderson, who will be our keynote speaker. Please take time to think about and ask critical written questions about the CRD's plans and the questions raised by ARREST's actions. Richard Atwell, who is somewhere here, will be circulating to pick up your written cards of the questions that you raise for the panel to address. We felt it was better for you to give us written questions that we will then ask our panel to address. We have got a panel assembled of distinguished scientists, which I will be introducing when we pick up those questions. And on the panel also will be David Anderson and Brian Birchall to answer the questions that you have put forward. At the end of the evening, which should finish by 9:15, John Bergbusch, the chairman of ARREST, will make final comments and talk about what ARREST is proposing for the future. I'm just going to now make a few introductory comments, a few minutes. I have to introduce myself, I'm afraid. I attended the University of Cambridge in England and later trained as a public health physician at the University of British Columbia in 1980. I was the medical health officer for the Capital Regional District here in Victoria from 89 to 95, and then was the deputy provincial health officer from 95 to 2004. My interest in the Victoria sewage treatment issue began in 1992. That was 20 years ago. At that time, there was a demand for increased sewage treatment. The CRD engineering department developed information packages and shopping center public information with widespread public feedback. A public referendum was then held, and the vote defeated any expenditure on increased treatment based on the information provided that was both scientific and financial. Then for many years, local elected officials then defended the effectiveness of the two engineered designed deep sea outfalls where the screened sewage is discharged, knowing that the scientific monitoring showed how effective this natural treatment of the sewage was. As time went on, the demand for land-based sewage treatment for Victoria again emerged, partly as a result of advocacy by such groups as the Georgia Strait Alliance, the Victoria Sewage Alliance, and POOP, people opposed to ocean pollution, including Mr. Floaty, and a reporter, Joel Connolly, from the Seattle Post-Intelligencer. Partly as a result of this, in 2006, the then Provincial Environment Minister, Barry Penner, and that's 6 years ago, ordered the CRD to come up with a plan for treatment. Since that time, the CRD has spent in the order of $20 million on studies for every conceivable design and technology that could be used, and they now have a bad plan, approved by the province for a treatment plant at McLaughlin Point, a new outfall, and 17-kilometer pipe to the Heartland landfill where the sludge will be treated and then disposed of somehow. The Canada-wide strategy for the management of municipal wastewater was endorsed by the Council of ministers representing four Canadian jurisdictions in February 2009. This was the result of at least 5 years of federal provincial discussions and meetings with input from all jurisdictions. This strategy recommended to the federal government that all municipalities in Canada, with exception of those in the far north, be required to meet objectives which are considered the equivalent of secondary sewage treatment, namely biochemical oxygen demand and total suspended solids, as well as chlorine and ammonia. As stated by the Federal of Canadian Municipalities, the final regulations published on July the 18th, 2012, conclude over 5 years of intensive intergovernmental partnership, research, and consultation involving all three orders of government as well as other stakeholders. FCM went on to say, there are concerns. The federal capital cost estimates are too low. Metro Vancouver estimates capital costs for its treatment systems will be $1.5 billion, nominal terms, yet the nominal federal capital cost estimate for the entire province of BC is approximately $570 million. I'm quoting directly from the FCM. The CRD staff reviewed the new regulations and stated in a report, the two core area outfalls, Clover Point and Macaulay Point, are considered higher risk facilities due to their large flow volumes and relatively high CBOD, the biological oxygen demand, and suspended solid concentrations, and will require upgrades by December 31st, 2020. This is the interpretation of the CRD staff. The core area wastewater treatment program has a timetable of approximately to 2018 to replace the Clover Point and Macaulay Point facilities with a secondary treatment plant at McLaughlin Point to meet the performance standards. On July the 16th, this summer, a press conference was held, and the federal and provincial governments announced, with several conditions attached, that the one-third funding for the federal and provincial governments was available for the project. The total cost of this plan is estimated to be $782.7 million. The total proposed federal contribution will be up to $253.4 million. The total provincial contribution is a maximum of $248 million. And the CRD will provide the balance, estimated at close to $281.3 million. The operating costs are quoted as $14.5 million a year. It's interesting that the provincial contribution they're subject to was that we're only going to give you the money when you've completed it, so there's really no firm contract for providing the funds. Following this announcement, the CRD has continued their planning, and just last week, the CRD held an information session for interested businesses, of which 120 groups signed up. The information presented by Jack Hull, the project manager, is available on the CRD website for those who might be interested. Sorry? The stated intent of the CRD is to create, by bylaw, an arm's length commission to manage this project with likely no public or political input, similar to that was created to build the Canada Line. The problem with the regulation under the Fisheries Act is that it takes a one-size-fits-all approach to treatment and does not acknowledge that there are, in some places like the waters of Victoria, where there is highly effective natural treatment, that has been shown to have a minimal effect on the marine environment and no measurable public health risk. This one-size-fits-all is a sort of mindset that got established amongst the regulators in Ottawa. As a matter of principle, I am opposed to the current plan because it has ignored the very credible view of our marine scientists, who you'll be hearing from today, about the effectiveness of our current deep sea outfalls in treating the sewage naturally. There have been many changes of political will and plans over the years, and there is still time for another change. Well, thank you. I tried to keep it as brief as I could, but I hope that gives you an update of where things are. I'd now like to introduce Brian Birchall, a member of ARREST and an engineer by training, and he's going to make a presentation.
It seems that my job this evening is to try to dispel some of the myths and PR spin that has been used to discredit the Victoria's current practice of natural marine treatment of our wastewater. Some terms, just to clarify, I'll use interchangeably the terms wastewater, sewage, and effluent. Also, what's being compared here is the proposed system and the current system of the proposed secondary treatment. And what we currently do is marine treatment. And part of the problem that around this issue is some people have serious misunderstanding of the method of marine treatment. The ocean, if it has the right conditions, can be used to treat wastewater. Unfortunately, many of our politicians don't understand that. And they think that there's just no such thing as, no such opportunity to put sewage into the ocean. They figure it's always a bad thing, it's always harmful. Certainly around the world you can find examples of disposal practices into the ocean where it is causing environmental and health problems, especially in third world countries. And so that, because those are sensational stories, what seems to have developed is just an overall view that any disposal into the ocean must therefore be a environmental and health hazard. And unfortunately, our federal environment minister, the Honorable Peter Kent, seems to have that view. Spokesperson refers to any disposal into the ocean as the dumping of raw sewage as a third world practice. And Victoria Mayor Dean Fortin recently has supported his view that we need to change our practice, is that we've got to get into the 21st century, that we cannot dump raw sewage into the ocean, is his view. Unfortunately, very misinformed. Well, you've heard that the federal wastewater regulations that came into effect, they impose a single standard across the country. Unfortunately, Canada's regulators insist on this single standard, despite the fact that the United States did this 20-some-odd years ago, no, more than that, 40 years ago, and they discovered that that objective of single standard on all ecosystems across the country was a flawed objective. In 1972, they implemented the Clean Water Act. Sorry, I'm just going to move ahead here. There it is, the Clean Water Act, 1972. Many US cities could foresee that conforming to this national standard would return little or no benefit to their local environment, and they objected to having the major infrastructure expense forced on them. Nearly 50 cities were granted waivers. They objected and they were granted waivers, and 50 of them granted waivers, more than that objected. But of the 50 or nearly 50 that were granted waivers, many of them had to go to court, such as San Diego. They had to go to court to, they had to resort to the courts. What happened was the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, took San Diego to court to try to force the city to comply with the Clean Water Act's requirement to install secondary sewage treatment. The state of California and the Sierra Club joined the EPA as interveners in the case. All three of them ganged up on the city of San Diego. When the city of San Diego presented the scientific evidence defending its practice of marine treatment of its wastewater, the state and the Sierra Club switched sides. They joined the city of San Diego against the EPA. The federal judge in the case struck down the EPA's order once he heard the science. As a matter of fact, a lot of the scientific evidence that was presented in that case, it was presented by oceanographers and marine scientists from the Scripps Institute of Ocean Sciences near San Diego. And the judge struck down the EPA's order because he was impressed with the science. So after 26 years of standing up for the truth against the EPA, the city of San Diego was finally received a waiver from the secondary treatment requirement. 26 years they fought it. The single nationwide standard caused such an uproar that the US Congress commissioned the National Research Council, the NRC, to review the regulations. In 1993, the NRC published recommendations which amounted to a rebuke of the single standard. Two recommendations that are particularly applicable to Victoria are, and I'll quote, one of them is, coastal wastewater and stormwater management strategies should be tailored to the particular receiving environment, unquote. The other recommendation that's certainly applicable to Victoria is, quote, source control of pollutants should be strongly encouraged by incentives and regulation, unquote. About 20 years before these recommendations were even published, CRD engineers, to their credit, tailored Victoria's system to our particular receiving environment. Oceanographic studies of the Salish Sea had identified a fortuitous set of conditions which give the Strait of Juan de Fuca the capacity to treat our wastewater. A massive amount of fresh water flows into the Salish Sea from several major rivers, including the Fraser River. And this fresh water continually flows toward the Pacific, staying mostly on the surface. Fresh water is lighter than salt water, so it stays on the surface, gradually mixing with the salt water as it continually flows to the Pacific. The entire Salish Sea region is, in effect, a large estuary. Deep Pacific ocean water, which is rich in microbes, flows into the estuary past Cape Flattery, mostly along the bottom half, the south half of the strait, so close to the Washington State shore, most of it. The undulating seafloor causes this flow to deflect upwards, pushing the water into contact with the atmosphere, giving the water a chance to absorb oxygen out of the atmosphere. This upwelling is especially strong where the seafloor rises amongst the San Juan and Gulf Islands. Also, strong tidal activity adds to the turbulence and keeps the straits well mixed. The inflow then turns back out to the Pacific, mostly along the northern half of the straits, so against the shores of southern Vancouver Island. This inflow and outflow is called estuarine circulation. Circulation in and out of the estuary, estuarine circulation. Hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, Doctor. A little bit of a tongue twister. The volume is huge, and it's continuous. Independent of the tides, this is flowing in continuously into the strait and back out. And it's a huge volume. And to summarize, the conditions that are created by all of this, the conditions in the strait are this huge volume that's continually replenishing the Strait of Juan de Fuca. It's microbe-rich, it's oxygen-rich, and the straits are well-mixed. Victoria discharges into these conditions in the outflow portion through the Macaulay and Clover Point outfalls. I've only intended to show the points at this point where they are located in Victoria. Now, an explanation of how our system works. Before the wastewater is discharged into the strait, it must pass through 6-millimeter screens to break up large particles and remove debris such as plastics, sticks, and leaves, and so on. 6-millimeter, you could maybe be able to fit a pencil through, so it's a fairly small hole in the screens. And all of the, also, they skim off grease and oils in the collection pools, and all the grease and oils and the screenings are trucked to Heartland and buried at Heartland Landfill. Once through the screens, the effluent then flows through outfall pipes that extend from Macaulay and Clover Points. And I realize it's rather dark. You can see the Clover Point, see the straight line there. The pipe extends out 1.2 kilometers. Off Macaulay Point, a little longer, 1.8 meters. The length of the pipes is needed to get out into that outflow portion of the estuarine circulation to carry our wastewater away to the Pacific. Now, occasionally, perhaps in a strong tide, some strong winds, the wastewater that comes out of the pipes could go eastward, probably just as far as Trial Island, but most of it certainly is headed, it will then eventually head to the Pacific. The overall flow is toward the Pacific. The effluent, our effluent, enters the marine environment through about 65 diffuser ports on the pipes, and the pipes are on the seafloor at about 60, 65 meters deep. Now, the effluent discharges at a rate out of the pipes, both pipes combined, discharges into the marine environment at a rate of approximately a cubic meter a second. So a cubic meter, about so wide, a big cube, roughly a cubic meter per second, which works out to, the reason I'll mention this, works out to just a little under 100 million liters per day. And I mention this because you'll most often see in the media, they keep using the figure of 130 million liters a day. That's not the case, that it's less than 100 million. So the media is getting that wrong. I haven't seen them quote it correctly yet. Maybe someday they will. It discharges, the effluent discharges into the outflow, but that outflow I mentioned is very large. It's about 100,000 times greater. What's flowing by us in the straits here, this estuarine flow coming into the straits and back out, is a volume of about 100,000 cubic meters a second going by us here. Now, to give you an idea, I realize I tossed several numbers around, so I'm just going to try to help you picture this. 100,000 cubic meters. This St. Anne's Academy is on a block that's surrounded by Humboldt Street, Academy Close, Quadra, and Blanchard. And if you were to try to picture a huge warehouse, a hollow warehouse, with the walls of the warehouse right out at the sidewalks all the way around this block, and picture the height of this warehouse, the ceiling of the warehouse, about twice the height of this ceiling. That's roughly 100,000 cubic meters. And we are discharging 1 meter into that, some 1 cubic meter into that. So this is all continuous. So let's just freeze frame and just look at 1 second, 100,000 cubic meters, and we put 1 cubic meter into it. This wastewater, let's take a closer look at it. What's it composed of? Well, actually, wastewater is composed of a little over 99.9% water. Mostly tap water, as a matter of fact. And 99.9%. So if we took this cubic meter of water and evaporated all the water off of it, what would be left? The organic and inorganic matter that's suspended in the water. What amount would it be? And I've got a little demonstration for you that once you dried all the water, so evaporated all the water, you'd be left with a dry powder. And you'd be left with that much, about 0.5 kilogram, about 1 pound of powder. That's what we're injecting into 100,000 cubic meters. I got to be careful, this white powder in a plastic bag, I'm talking about a 0.5 kilo. Anybody want 0.5 kilo? So I'm keeping it hidden away here. So the effluent disperses into this 100,000 cubic meters. It's well mixed, lots of turbulence. It disperses rapidly. True, it's not instantly dispersed into the entire 100,000 cubic meters, but as it heads to the Pacific, all the turbulence is continually diluting it, dispersing it. It disperses so rapidly, but by the time it's only 100 meters away from the pipes, it's diluted, and I mentioned 100 meters because that's they call it the initial dilution zone. That's where they take regulation measurements to find out just how dilute the wastewater has become in the marine environment. And at the 100 meters, the readings for our outfall are 20 to 25 times lower than the regulation maximum for British Columbia's regulations. So extremely dilute, our system is working incredibly well. As the turbulence causes it to continue to disperse, microbes and oxygen assimilate it into the food chain of the Strait and the Northeast Pacific. Until it is assimilated, it just disperses to natural background levels of organic matter that's always suspended in the seawater. Now, I mentioned this pound of material that's being injected into the flow. Certainly, we all are concerned about, well, it's not all simple organic matter that you can just toss on the compost. We're concerned about deleterious substances, as they're called. Well, the most effective way to prevent deleterious substances from entering wastewater is to simply ban production of them, as was done with PCBs and will be done with fire retardants eventually. Since it's very difficult or impossible for any treatment system to remove 100% of the deleterious substances once they're in the wastewater at concentrations of parts per million, billion, trillion, the next most effective way to manage them is to try to prevent them from being put into the system at all, a practice called source control. Remember that term from the NRC recommendations? Source control. Source control of many pharmaceuticals and personal care products, though, is very difficult. Luckily, they are extremely dilute and slowly degrade in the marine environment. A criticism of our current practice is that it's contaminating the seafloor. Contamination of the seafloor off Victoria's waterfront was begun by past practices of dumping barge loads of our garbage in the strait. And here's a picture in the upper right corner of a barge down by Johnson Street Bridge being loaded with Victoria's trash, which would have included car batteries, fluorescent light tubes, lead paint, things that nobody would think of putting into the trash into the effluent these days. Back then we did. That practice was stopped in 1958, stopped dumping out in the streets. But also, concentrations of deleterious substances in our discharge are in decline because the CRD has implemented source control programs, and they're continually improving and expanding those programs. So the deleterious substances in our wastewater is declining. What is still being discharged either falls to the sediments or disperses to infinitesimal concentrations in the straits. The concentration of discharge is so low, the concentration in the discharge, I should say, is so low these days that even though Victoria's population is increasing, seafloor contamination is decreasing. And that's because the deposits of past practices are degrading faster than the present rate that we are depositing onto the seafloor. Does our disposal practice have a negative effect on human health? Dr. Peck addressed some of that. I had the good fortune to hear it stated a little more strongly from Dr. Peck recently. He explained to me that if an illness had occurred which could reasonably be attributed to our discharge practice, the law requires that the GP notify a public health officer of that finding. No such notification has ever occurred. There's no record of anybody getting sick from our discharge practice. Data that's been collected by the CRD, there's continual monitoring of our practice, of our discharges into the ocean, and a lot of data has been collected, a lot of reports, a lot of evidence. It's all been reviewed by many qualified professionals, including public health officers, wastewater engineers, CRD staff, and scientists from the Institute of Ocean Sciences, the University of Victoria, private consulting firms, and Washington State. Some of them are here this evening. Here's one such review. And Dr. Chris Garrett is one of the authors. He's here this evening. The authors of this review and many other marine scientists have gone on record stating that they do not see any urgent need for land-based treatment, and that the CRD's current sewage disposal practice is a relatively minor issue here on the Straits of Juan de Fuca. And remember, some of the authors in these reports are from Washington State. We hear a lot of concern from Washington State. They don't like what we're doing. But the scientists who review it, the scientists from Washington State, don't see a problem. It's a minor issue. Also, I realize I should mention about the flows that I mentioned, the estuarine flow, because it comes in on the southern shore and comes back out along the shore of southern Vancouver Island, our discharges do not get into Puget Sound or over into Port Angeles. Our practice is not affecting them. The negative impact on the marine environment by our disposal practice is so minor that local waters are frequently referred to as pristine. Articles in magazines, newspapers frequently refer to, and this is an article just in July of this year, of a kayaker that's back and forth across the Victoria waterfront for, I think she said, for the last 15 years or so, and she sees no evidence of sewage, and once again, another article about the pristine waters. The negative effect on our marine environment is so minor that waters off Macaulay Point itself are used for field trips by UVic to study the local natural marine environment. And just 15 kilometers downstream from Victoria's outfalls, we have the Marine Ecological Reserve at Race Rocks. With some minor changes, our system would even qualify for a waiver under the US regulations, and it almost certainly would meet the stringent standards of the European Union. Now I'd like to talk about some of the very positive effects our system is having on the marine environment. Sea life actually is thriving around the outfalls. Another accusation about our system is that it's causing dead zones around the outfalls. In fact, sea life is thriving around the outfalls. Here's some photographs taken from a submarine that's, oh my goodness, very dark, but it can barely make out there's some sea stars. This is also a photograph that I believe shows some scallops and mussels and anemone. Also, a sea slug. That's actually a sea slug, that dark spot. And crabs, they're right up on the pipe, right on the outfall pipe. And this last one, hope we can see it. Yes, some fish. These are copper rockfish, some sea pens. Now, what's out of view in any of these photographs is in the sediments are worms that are functioning like organisms in the digester ponds of a land-based secondary sewage treatment system. Those worms are in the sediment, and the natural system around the outfalls would not function without them. In the same way that Victoria's garden composters would not function without earthworms. Charles Darwin spent years of his life documenting that worms are essential to the health of an ecosystem. The next picture is packed with CRD data about marine life around the discharges. Now, it's a bar graph, and I hope that I hesitated about whether or not I should include this. It might look a little bit daunting, but this is loaded with so much very important information about what's happening around the outfalls that I hope I can walk you through this and help you understand just how good and how effective our outfalls are and how positive one of the effects is. What this graph is showing is the amount of biomass and the distance from the pipe. So this is the greatest distance from the pipe, and this is at the pipe. And you notice the trend is increasing toward the pipe. The closer you get to the pipe, the more sea life there is. Thank you. First surprise. Now, these colors, this is very important. Each color represents a particular animal group at that location. That's the amount of a measurement of the amount of that animal group. Each color is a different animal group. And what's very important, what this graph is showing us, is that there's a diversity of life at every measurement. What it also shows, another very important feature, is no one animal group dominates. And these two facts together, the fact that there's a diversity of animal groups and that no one animal group dominates, is indicative of a healthy ecosystem. Very contrary to the story that the practice is causing dead zones. I don't know which color relates to which animal group. That question perhaps could be answered later. Maybe one of the oceanographers could answer that. The key thing is that there's a diversity and no one group dominates.
Chris said it's the worms.
It's the worms? The red is the worms. All right, thank you. Another justification that's given for this planned project to proceed is that the projected population growth for the CRD makes the current practice unsustainable. I want to address that. Elizabeth May herself, who's not in support of the plan, has also expressed concern about, and she worded it a little differently, that the current practice is not sustainable for forever. These concerns beg the question, how much can we increase the rate of discharge before the strait's ability to assimilate is stressed? I put the question to two of UVic's oceanographers, and they tell me that no study has been done to determine the strait's limit. So I suggest that rather than spend $1 billion on a system that we might not even need yet, wouldn't it be more prudent to fund a study to predict the population the strait could sustain? Thank you. As for the estimated construction cost of $782 million. A 2009 study out of California titled Delusion and Deception in Large Infrastructure Projects. You got it. warns that the cost overruns of 50% are common in large infrastructure projects. That certainly is our experience in British Columbia. Let's take a look at this table. Fast Ferries, 120% overrun. Vancouver Convention Center, 78% overrun. BC Place Revitalization, 55%. Portman Highway, 121% cost overrun. What's your faith in the idea that there won't be a cost overrun in this project? Got some numbers down here, which I should explain. This number is the estimated cost for all of the infrastructure that will be built by 2030. Who knows what the cost overruns will be. But about the cost overruns, I want to speak a bit more on that. Given that the very existence of this project is due to irrational thinking of local politicians and a flawed, irrational law of a single standard imposed on the entire country, I personally have little faith that there will be rational control of our tax dollars to prevent cost overruns. Also, I should mention the one-third sharing formula, all three levels of government sharing the one-third, as Dr. Peck mentioned to us, does not apply to the cost overruns. CRD taxpayers will be responsible for 100% of cost overruns. Okay, as Dr. Peck mentioned, the planned operating system is supposed to hopefully get operating by 2018 and will be at capacity by 2030. So $1 billion for 12 years of service, and then it's at capacity. Then they'll have to build more. And the estimations from the CRD website is for all three, like this one being proposed, phase one, I believe it's three phases total of $1.2 to $2 billion for all three phases. So much money, our tax dollars, is being committed to this project that the bidding process, I have to say, is starting to look like a feeding frenzy. Dreams of sewage plant bonanza draws a crowd. We have significant concerns about the design of the planned system. Construction of a twin pipeline from McLaughlin Point to Heartland Landfill will disrupt neighborhoods. And that's the right hand. There's the pipeline from McLaughlin Point to Heartland Landfill. The routing would be along Victoria View Road, Lamson Street, Tillicum Road, Interurban, West Saanich, and Heartland Roads. Certainly going to disrupt those neighborhoods as they put in twin pipelines. The Clover Point to McLaughlin connector, I think they're calling it, this section here from Clover Point across the waterfront along Dallas Road through Beacon Hill Park and through James Bay and past the cruise ship terminal and under the harbor, a tunnel under the harbor to McLaughlin Point. Certainly is going to disrupt the neighborhoods. Also, an important thing to mention about this pipe is it's going to be pressurized. So if it should spring a leak, pressure will be forced, yes, that's right, and probably force it to the surface. Just as happened over in Burnaby, with the Kinder Morgan pipeline, oil pipeline, when it sprung a leak, pressure pushed the oil to the surface. Sorry, the picture is rather dark, but that's oil all through there. We would have the same problem with a spill along through Beacon Hill Park and James Bay. In this case, what would happen if it was much of a spill, it would end up flowing into the ocean, particularly this section under the harbor. A break in the pipe there would enter the ocean. But need to clarify that the currents along the shore here don't carry it away. The currents close to shore hold the materials close to shore, and it would drive them up into the harbor. So a spill from this would be not a very good tourist attraction, let's put it that way. One of the concerns they have is that our current practice is driving tourists away. Don't think that a leak here would do much for tourism. And other concerns we have about this project is that production of construction materials, for example, concrete, that's a very polluting process. Transport of the materials, all this will produce a lot of greenhouse gases. Construction processes will consume a lot of energy. If the system is built, there will be a perpetual demand for energy to pump the sewage uphill 200 meters to Heartland, 200 meter rise in elevation. That line will always be pressurized. As a matter of fact, part of the disruption, they're going to have to put five pumping stations along that line. This megaproject is in direct conflict with municipal commitments to reduce greenhouse gases and our carbon footprint. Particularly disturbing about this project is that it's going to proceed without either an environmental impact assessment and also without a cost-benefit analysis. They're just saying that the law says we have to do it. So they're bypassing these two very important steps that should be done. Without a cost-benefit analysis, we can't compare the proposed secondary sewage treatment with the system with our current practice. So there's no justification, sensible, rational justification, for the major expenditure to replace our system. Now, a little bit about secondary sewage treatment. It should remove more of the deleterious substances than our current practices, the practice does. But it won't remove all, and it won't remove the pharmaceuticals. And I should mention that some of this removal will just be a transfer. When liquids and solids are separated at Heartland, the substances that we're concerned about, which are currently diluted in our effluent and diluted into the ocean, will become concentrated in the sludge. And the intention, originally the intention was to truck the sludge to Vancouver and burn it in kilns, cement kilns in Vancouver. The latest, as of Saturday, I think Jack Hull said, no, they've stopped that idea. They're just going to bury this sludge in Heartland landfill. So the sludge, which will be have concentration of toxins, will be buried. So where's the benefit in that? Any benefit will come at the cost of substantially greater energy demand and environmental impact, of increased greenhouse gas emissions to build and operate, and the cost of disruption of the neighborhoods, the ever-present danger of failure of pipelines. It's very doubtful that the planned project will create a net environmental benefit for Victoria. In comparison, our current system of natural treatment is tailored to that fortuitous combination of mixing and dilution in seawater that is microbe and oxygen rich, and that dissolves and assimilates our waste into the food chain. This natural action that we're utilizing in the Straits is equivalent to the action of aeration and digester ponds of land-based secondary treatment complex. However, those ponds require large amounts of energy to operate and must continue to operate in the event of a power failure. The energy for our practice is the natural action in the Strait that's not only free, but renewable and reliable because it comes from the tides and the estuarine circulation. To compare the reliability of the proposed system with our current practice, you'd have to ask yourself, when was the last time the tides didn't come in? The new federal wastewater regulations state, and there's some pictures of digester ponds and aeration ponds. Sorry. Digester ponds and an aeration pond at a sewage complex. Takes up a lot of land space, a lot of energy input. Now, I was starting to mention, I want to quote the a part of the federal wastewater. Actually, okay, got to be careful. This is not in the regulations, but it's on the Government of Canada website. It's the objective of the regulations, and I'll read it. The objective of the regulations is to reduce the threats to fish, fish habitat, and human health from fish consumption by decreasing the level of deleterious and harmful substances deposited to Canadian surface water from wastewater effluent. Given that our practice here is very carefully, thoroughly monitored by one of the most intensive outfall monitoring programs in the world, and there's 40 years of data that's been collected, and has not detected any such threat to our environment. Victorians should put pressure, I believe, on CRD and provincial politicians to notify Ottawa that our existing treatment system is in compliance with the objective and spirit of the regulations, and that therefore the intention to replace our system is simply a bad plan. And I'd like to finish on a political note. Let's not let this drag on for 26 years. Let's do it in the 26 weeks that we have left before the next provincial election in May. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sean, and thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for coming out this evening, the night of the American presidential debate. So we seem to have preempted Obama and Mitt Romney, so that's great. Now, to quote Yogi Berra, there is an air of deja vu all over again on this issue of artificial on-land secondary sewage treatment for the Capital Regional District. 20 years ago, artificial on-land sewage treatment was proposed for the Capital Regional District for the area which is the southern part of the Capital Regional District. You saw earlier the two outfalls that go into the Strait of Juan de Fuca. I would remind people that the Capital Regional District has a number of sewage treatment plants in areas such as North Saanich and Salt Spring Island, where water conditions are not the same as they are in the Strait of Juan de Fuca. We do not irresponsibly refuse to have treatment everywhere. We say responsibly, we don't do it where it's not necessary. In any event, we had a big debate at that time, 20 years ago. There were articles in the Times Colonist. There were information meetings. There were resource people with oceanographers available and marine biologists. And ultimately, we had a referendum in the Capital Regional District. And the proposal to treat, to put in a secondary treatment plant went down by a vote of 57% to 43%, defeated. Now, the issue has returned, or perhaps I should say, it never really went away. So let me start by describing some of the attitudes that we face in this discussion or debate. And the arguments vary. Sometimes they're based on the need for a modern approach, and that has been referred to already. We have heard the chair of the Wastewater Committee of the Capital Regional District say that it is time for the scientists whose research cannot find scientific justification for treatment. She suggested that they join the 21st century, change their position, and ignore their scientific findings. Being modern is to embrace treatment. Being old-fashioned is to oppose it. Modernity is important. Scientific rigor is not. Now, sometimes you have the fairness argument, and this is a really important one. Other cities have to provide artificial on-land secondary treatment of wastewater, so it is unfair that Victoria gets a free ride. Now, this non-sequitur is particularly powerful and has played a big role in our present predicament. Some of you laughed a moment ago, and quite rightly, because it really is a non-sequitur. But in a recent CFAX interview, Mr. Jeff Young, the chair of the CRD, perceived it as being unfair and gave it as the reason that we should proceed with treatment. Even though he agreed that the CRD reports on the current system, the CRD engineers and technicians' reports on the current system show that treatment is unnecessary. Other cities, he said, which he did not identify, think it's unfair that Victoria gets a free ride on the costs of treatment. Science and years of careful observation of impact by CRD technicians simply was brushed aside in that interview. Now, third, there are those who have faith in human ingenuity and technology and very little faith in natural systems. These people believe that mankind can always improve on nature. Engineering solutions beat natural ones, so bring on the steel, the concrete, the plastic, and the pumping stations. And that is a genuine problem that we face. Some people simply believe it has to be better if it's done by humankind. Fourth, there are people who are unable to understand the difference between the vast tidal movements of water in the Strait of Juan de Fuca and the, by comparison, minor water flows of rivers such as the Bow, the Saskatchewan River, or the Red River. Calgary doesn't dump sewage into the river, so Victoria shouldn't dump it into the Strait of Juan de Fuca either, is something I have heard a number of times by recent immigrants from Calgary who seem to believe that their experience is definitely a guide for us here. Now, finally, there is a desire among some for conformity, and this is a powerful argument, a one-size-fits-all in the government regulations. And this is a major factor. One-size-fits-all is so easy to administer. You don't need to use judgment. You simply have to see whether it measures up to the rule. A system tailored to receiving water quality requires some judgment and some knowledge. Now, I had this problem in spades in my time as environment minister, indeed, specifically on the question of the treatment of Victoria's wastewater. It is described as making regulations easier to enforce and to understand, but in essence, it is an argument designed to make the life of the regulator easier. Specifically on the issue of the on-land secondary treatment for Victoria, this argument was put to me, and of course I rejected it, as I did in other situations elsewhere in the country. When you're dealing with a $1 billion project to be funded by the taxpayer, the administrative convenience of a one-size-fits-all approach comes, as far as I'm concerned, at far too high a price. Fifth, we hear the argument that it is a done deal. Nothing can be done to reverse it. And last week, the chair of the Wastewater Committee of the CRD argued that it is pointless to continue to oppose on-land secondary treatment because it is too late. She used the term, the train has left the station. I wonder if she knew that she was paraphrasing a line of Lenin's 95 years ago during the Russian Revolution. Now, a quick look at the history. The driver of the revival of interest in on-land artificial secondary treatment has been the provincial government of Premier Gordon Campbell. Now, was his interest in on-land artificial secondary treatment the result of a scientific study or a report that landed on his desk? No, not at all. Strangely, it was as a result of a press interview about the Olympics, of all things. Now, you'll recall that about a decade ago, Premier Campbell was committing the province to very substantial expenditures for the Olympic Games. And I, at that time, was the federal minister responsible for British Columbia. And for that reason, as well as being a former Olympic athlete myself, I was heavily involved and very interested in the Olympic Games discussions with the province. And as part of the build-up and the promotion of the Games, the Premier was interviewed about the Olympics by Mr. Joel Connolly, a writer for the Seattle Times, who for years has been preaching the unfairness of Victoria not treating its wastewater, while American cities on Puget Sound being required to do so under the American legislation that you heard about a short time ago. Now, incidentally, Mr. Connolly always ignores the fact that San Diego, which has similar ocean conditions to Victoria, was exempted from the US legislation, and he also ignores the fact that were Victoria situated in the United States subject to American legislation, in all likelihood, we would be exempted as well. But that's beside the point. So when questioning the Premier, Mr. Connolly asked him whether the Premier was concerned about the prospect of a boycott of the Olympics by Americans by reason of the lack of on-land secondary treatment for Victoria's wastewater, something that he had assiduously written about and pressed in his columns in the Seattle Times. Now, the Premier was deeply concerned about the threat to his legacy project, and he decided to play along and declare himself troubled by the lack of treatment in Victoria. That's the genesis of our current problem. Nothing to do with science, nothing to do with anything else, but in fact, the concern of the Premier of the province over a boycott of the Olympics. Well, the Olympics took place and there was no boycott, so probably there would never have been a boycott. However, the cat was out of the bag, and to cut a long story short, What happened in time led the Environment Ministry to issue a letter to the CRD asking for secondary treatment or its equivalent. Now, at that time, the CRD had an opportunity to vigorously dispute the basis of the letter. Remember those 26 years of litigation of San Diego? I don't suggest the CRD could have embarked on 26 years of litigation, but at least they could have shown a little backbone at that time and dispute the basis of the letter and to say what its engineers, what the CRD engineers and the environmental staff had been reporting to the board year after year, namely that in terms of impact on the environment of the Greater Victoria Region, its waterfront and the Strait of Juan de Fuca, the present natural system was fully the equivalent of an on-land artificial secondary treatment system. But the CRD did not do that. Instead, pro-treatment CRD members ignored the words, or its equivalent, and misread the letter as a command by the province to proceed. So, the Olympics came and went, Premier Campbell went, but thanks to the CRD's failure to insist on justification for the action called for in the directive, it is still with us. And we now have spent some $26 million on the project, which is mostly CRD money. The contribution of the federal and provincial governments is quite small. And we're on the verge of spending hundreds of millions more. You heard about the meeting of the contractors and other people interested in working on the project and the meeting they had just recently. Oh, by the way, that brings up the issue of funding. Funding did provide a temporary obstacle to this project going ahead. But earlier this summer, we had a meeting of the federal and provincial ministers along with the CRD, and there was an attractive piece of political theater on the waterfront when the federal and provincial ministers announced contributions of roughly $250 million each. However, there were serious caveats to the federal promise. Despite the fact this has been interpreted as the go-ahead, the promise of money, remember these two caveats. The project must pass an environmental assessment, and it must get Treasury Board approval. Now, the province's commitment was even more slippery. BC will not provide any money until the on-land treatment system is up and running, which at the earliest, assuming no delays, and delays, well, you saw the over-cost overruns. Delays are sort of like cost overruns. They seem to occur quite frequently. Assuming there's no cost overruns, still the completion date is 2018, 6 years hence. Neither the federal nor the provincial government has put the commitment it made then in writing. So, is this a done deal? Has the train really left the station? Now, let me now speak as a politician from my own experience and say, not at all. The money has not been spent, and in politics, the train doesn't leave the station until the money is gone. Now, how can I say that with such confidence? Well, I spent more than 10 years as a federal cabinet minister, and during the first four of those years, the Chrétien government was struggling to get the budget balance from the deficits run up by the previous Mulroney government. I spent 2.5 years as transport minister in that first period, and I was responsible for cutting the transport department's budget in half. The transport department had the largest cut of any government department. And I could never have done that had I put the money into all the airports or the other transportation facilities that the Mulroney government had promised in each and every corner of the country. It was just a question of saying no, and saying it firmly, and when the reply came back, as it invariably did, that the expenditure had been promised by my conservative predecessor, I would simply point out that our government had made balancing the budget a priority, and the previous government had not. A new government had new priorities. Past promises were no longer valid. A past government or minister cannot, in our democratic system, bind its successor. Now, if anyone seriously doubts this, think of the cancellation of the Mulroney helicopter purchase by Mr. Chrétien shortly after taking office. Yes, it cost money because there were contractual obligations, but the helicopter purchase was canceled. Or another one that hit me rather hard, because I was a revenue minister, was Mr. Chrétien campaigned on getting rid of the GST. He got into office and we discovered, and I was one of those who had to tell him, you couldn't get rid of the GST because it was such an efficient tax. I'm glad I wasn't called in for the HST debate. Nevertheless, you know, he changed his mind because he discovered things that he had not known before. Again, it was widely reported he had broken a promise. Well, maybe he had, maybe he hadn't, but he certainly had changed his mind. And that's another example of a change that took place against expectation. Think of Mr. Harper, if you wish to find a conservative prime minister who changes his mind. A very short time ago, just a few years, 3 or 4 years ago, he was in the Arctic promising military bases here, there, and everywhere. It was going to be a very substantial military presence in the Arctic. Since then, he has canceled all but one, and that is essentially a refueling station. So even the same person can make cancellations of promises that have been made at previous times. So a program can be changed, it can be eliminated, it can be reprofiled, it can be reconfigured, and the only real way to be sure that doesn't happen is to spend the money. If the money's not spent, it's open for change. Now, don't forget also the two conditions put on the federal contribution. What is being proposed by the CRD Committee on Wastewater, the two conditions proposed by the CRD. What is being proposed by the Committee on Wastewater is environmentally less attractive from a variety of points of view that have been mentioned earlier, greenhouse gases, resources, water, air quality, etc., than the current system. A federal environmental impact report to that effect, which they said would have to happen, if that came out, the promise evaporates. And on the financial side, if Treasury Board examines the present system and compares it to the proposed system of the CRD, once again, it's finding that the new system is less financially viable, is less value for money than the present system, once again, the promise of the federal government evaporates. And don't forget again, the provincial contribution is contingent on the federal contribution being paid out first. So if it doesn't come, the provincial payment doesn't come either. Under those circumstances, you have the CRD taxpayer picking up the full tab for the entire $783 million, plus, of course, as we know already, the overruns that will likely take place. Now, of course, this doesn't mean that the two senior governments will not pay up the money as outlined earlier this summer. They may, but there is no firm commitment, and the CRD statement said it would not proceed until there were firm commitments and signed agreements has been quietly forgotten. It does mean that the CRD is taking serious risks on senior government contributions. The point to remember is, the province has not entered into any binding agreement to set aside the money in next year's budget, and nor, in fact, has the federal government. Now, in the list of arguments that we faced, there was a constant theme. The science can be ignored. Well, that is true in politics, up to a point. There can be times when emotionalism trumps the science, and today there are plenty of examples of policies based on unsustainable development models where science has been put in the back seat or not taken into account at all. But I spent 7 years as minister of two science departments, fisheries and oceans and environment, and if a government is going to ignore science, it makes a great deal of good sense to at least be aware what knowledge and insights you have decided to ignore or minimize. Ignorance can be very costly. Faced with science advice, a government should give it careful analysis before rejecting it or rejecting any part of it. The science may have limitations, but it is generally the best guide you have for good administrative decisions. So in the case at hand, we have various reasons put forward for proceeding with treatment, but the basic one is ignorance about the virtues of the current system. Close behind are the fairness issues to communities that do not have the Strait of Juan de Fuca at their doorstep. Surely the appropriate way to proceed when faced with the unusual situation of some of the very best academic scientists, the people from the closest institution most familiar with local conditions, is to evaluate their views and opinions. Surely the starting point for an evaluation of what is going on and what benefits there may be is right here at UVic. Now, I know that the definition of an expert is someone with an accent who comes from out of town, and that the Florida-based SeaTac group and their report is considered by some, people who've not read it, to justify on-land secondary treatment. But what about having the report peer-reviewed by the UVic experts? I admit bias. I represented the university for many years in Parliament, and I think UVic is a first-rate institution which has earned its place among the top 10 of the thousands of universities that have been established worldwide during the past 50 years, a position I think we all should be proud of. But even if the CRD and the provincial government do not share my faith in the quality of the University of Victoria or my enthusiasm for it, surely even they must admit that UVic ranks very high. So I would suggest that we at least demand that the people at UVic who have taken the unusual step of writing a public letter, the 10 scientists, marine biologists, oceanographers, and others, and also a former dean of science, who've taken the steps of writing a public letter, at least have their views properly examined and at least are asked to peer review the SeaTac report. Now, the final point on which I feel deeply as a politician of many years is the responsibility people in public office have to spend money wisely. Of course, there'll be times when things don't work out, when expenditures are higher than expected and results are less. But then that happens in other fields of personal and private life as well. But that is no reason for abandoning the worthwhile goal of trying to make sure that you spend money wisely. In the final analysis, the role of the elected official is to steer public expenditures in the direction of where society thinks those funds can provide the greatest benefit. Remember, all funds can be used somewhere else. If you take money and put it into something that has little benefit, and from the environmental point of view, such as is being proposed by the CRD, you are taking it away from other worthwhile causes, perhaps causes in the medical field or hospital field, perhaps in the schools, perhaps other environmental causes, such as, for example, dealing with the much more pressing issue, in my view, of road runoff, stormwater runoff. If you take money and use it this way, you can't use it in another way. And that's what politicians' major function is, to determine the direction of public expenditures. to refuse to consider costs and benefits of a project with such a substantial price tag as the one we're considering today, and to refuse to compare those costs and benefits with the current system, is a breathtaking failure to carry out this fundamental political responsibility. Here. Taxpayers. Taxpayers in Greater Victoria will be providing the tax dollars for the CRD We will be providing the tax dollars for the province, and we will be providing the tax dollars for the federal government to fund this project. You can be quite sure that if this region goes ahead with this kind of project, and it is not responsible and rigorous examination is not given to it, the same thing will happen in other regions, and we will wind up paying the full shot. So it's really important to make sure that we give it that kind of examination. It is a complete cop-out to say it is too late. It is a complete cop-out to say it doesn't matter. It is a complete cop-out to say, oh, well, it's not fair somehow. We're going to spend the money anyway. Money spent should be getting the best possible return for the public. Or indeed, if you can't find a return for the public, the money should not be spent at all. The public, and that is ourselves, are entitled to objective information on what they're being required to pay for. And just the final point, we are entering a period where it is likely that economic conditions are going to be a great deal more difficult than they have been in the last 10 years. Much more difficult. The economy is, our economy is going well, yes, but it's likely it will not be as successful as the world economy has its downturn, the expected downturn of the next few years. To get involved in expenditures which take us into that period, expenditures which have no benefit, is the height of irresponsibility. Thank you very much.
I've introduced David Anderson, and the next person getting on the stage is Dr. Jack Littlepage. Dr. Littlepage is a retired biological oceanographer at the University of Victoria. His primary interest has been zooplankton and marine food webs. He developed and implemented the initial CRD marine outfall monitoring program in the 1970s. He has been active in marine pollution research from 1970 to the present, and he is currently with the Center for Global Studies at the University of Victoria. The next person sitting next to David Anderson is Dr. Michael Whittaker, Professor of Biogeochemistry, School of Earth and Ocean Sciences, University of Victoria. After his PhD in organic geochemistry at Kiel, Germany, Dr. Whittaker worked as a research chemist with Petro-Canada in Calgary before joining the Federal Institute of Geosciences in Hanover, Germany as a stable isotope geochemist. Dr. Whittaker returned to Canada to help found the School of Earth and Ocean Sciences in 1990. His specialty is organic geochemistry and stable isotope biotech. Next to him is Dr. Vera Pospielova. Have I got the spelling right? I hope so. Associate Professor, School of Earth and Ocean Sciences, University of Victoria. She's an expert in assessing marine sediments and determining the environmental impacts. Her research group is using organic walled microfossils, dinoflagellate cysts, foraminiferal organic linings, pollen and spores, etc., and geochemical proxies as indicators of past and present environmental conditions. And on the end, we have Dr. Chris Garrett, a physical oceanographer. He's the former Lansdowne Professor of Ocean Physics at the University of Victoria. He was a member of the, as you saw, the 1993-94 BC Washington Marine Science Panel that reported to both governments on the health of our shared marine waters. And he was a member of the CRD's Marine Monitoring Advisory Group for 9 years, from 2001 to 2010. And he chaired it from 2009 to 2010. So there's our panel, and moving right along, has anybody got any questions from the floor? I do have a few that we thought up ahead of time, and in fact, I think I will start off by... great, thank you very much. Well, here's a question. Would a number of smaller sewage treatment plants like the one at the Dockside Green be a better option than the CRD sewage treatment plant? Anyone want to have a go at that one? That was all examined by the CRD, and I would like to recognize that Vic Derman is here, who's a member of the Sewage Treatment Committee, and after we've had this panel, I'm going to give Vic the mic for a few minutes before we wrap up. Anyhow, I think maybe that one cannot, that may not be able to be answered by...
Sean, Vera.
Vera, okay.
The answer would be definitely not, and the reason is because can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm not a great public speaker, so I apologize, but what I want to tell you, when the sewage discharges, you'll have ammonia in the water which goes into the waters, and no sewage treatment plant will extract this nutrient from the water, and when you put it in the marine environment, the algae, phytoplankton, will take it up and will bloom. So by having and planting or placing these small sewage treatment plants as it was around the Greater Victoria, as was originally proposed, is not a good idea because they will be closer to the area and discharge this sewage water already treated, but still having high nutrient content in the water where the flushing rate is relatively small, and it will cause blooms. If you go to the Oak Bay Marina, have you noticed there's some kind of the water sometimes smelly, right? And there's a blooms. It's because the storm water, which is rich in nutrients, leaks in this part of the bay, and because of the flushing rate of this water is really low, it causes blooms. So by placing multiple small sewage treatment plants around the Victoria, we'll create more habitats like that. Okay.
Thank you very much, Vera. A question I've got here for Dr. Jack Littlepage. It has been documented by the CRD that the standards in the new wastewater system effluent regulations are being met if an initial dilution zone is agreed, as it was previously by the Ministry of the Environment. Can you comment on this? Okay. It has been documented at the CRD that the standards in the new wastewater system effluent regulations are being met if an initial dilution zone is agreed, as it was previously by the BC Ministry of the Environment. Can you comment on this?
Okay. Thank you. I have not seen the letter that Dr. Beck has referred to, but I can say from the measurements that I've seen and the information, the short answer is there's no question. But I want to digress a moment and talk about this concept of the internet, initial dilution zone, or IDZ. When the regulations promulgated, they measure materials coming out the end of a pipe before anything happens to this material. This is fine if this pipe then goes into a concrete wall treatment plant, and at the end of the passage through this plant, you measure the materials, and they now will pass the requirements that were laid down for within the pipe materials. This, when you look at marine discharge, we have to, without question, depend upon the ocean to do the natural treatment, which is being done by a sewage treatment plant. And so the analogous situation of forcing us to measure our impact at the opening of the pipe as it discharges into the ocean would be very similar to measuring the efficiency of a land-based sewage treatment plant by measuring the material going into the plant. In other words, it doesn't simply apply to the marine system. The other thing that I should say regarding passing the regulations, we would fail without doubt on one item, and that is, it is required that we use rainbow trout. and I have not seen too many rainbow trout surviving in the ocean. By the regulations, we would have to use rainbow trout to assay the water passing out of the initial dilution zone. So with that caveat, we could easily, and I mean by orders of magnitude, meet all of the federal and provincial requirements.
Thank you very much, Jack. I will. I've got a large number of questions here, and so some of these are just suggestions. I'll read out one of them. Can this message be publicized in a format that people will see clearly the folly of this bad plan, i.e. on the news, in the papers, in magazines, maybe public talks, presentations at UVic? And I think ARES will certainly take that sort of comment in. What steps can we do to stop the CRD? What can we do? I think at the end of the meeting, John Burgbush will touch on that issue. There's a couple of questions about will the treatment center remove compounds of dangerous heavy metals? And there was another one about chemicals of concern and pharmaceuticals and other products. And I was wondering whether Chris Garrett might like to comment on that one, because I know that even if you haven't done the research yourself, you may. So who'd like to answer that one?
Shall I attempt the pharmaceuticals? I'm a physicist, so this is kind of out of my field, but I've read a bit about it and I've talked to the people at the CRD. And actually, for starters, I would like to pay great credit to the wonderful engineers at the CRD who designed, built, and operate the present excellent system. And I'd like to pay great credit too. And great credit too to the scientists down at the CRD who have this outstanding monitoring program. So if you talk to them, and you kind of, for pharmaceuticals and personal care products, you kind of have to go through a long list one by one. You cannot just say things are harmless or toxic. But if you say, well, what should we be worried about? Something that tends to come to the top of the list, as I understand it, is something called 17-alpha ethanol estradiol. And don't ask me to spell it, but it's short, it's known as EE2. And this is something that is an estrogen, and it comes largely from metabolites of birth control pills. And this is something which, remarkably, even in a concentration of parts per trillion, which is like a drop in many swimming pools, could cause harm to larval freshwater fish. The marine studies, I don't think, have been done. So, and in fact, the concentration in the raw effluent is such that one would be concerned. But if you then say, A, will land-based treatment take care of it? Only partly, and you might then just concentrate on the sludge, where it might eventually degrade. And does it cause a problem in the marine environment? Almost certainly not, because once you dilute it in the water by hundreds or thousands of times, it's no longer a problem according to any studies that have been done. Moreover, some of it might be trapped to sediments and it would sink to the seafloor in the 100 meters or so near Macaulay outfall particularly, and then it would just slowly degrade in the still oxygen-rich environment that is present. So if you go through things one by one, you tend to say there are things we should analyze, but nothing we are presently concerned about, nor likely to be concerned about in the future. And I think Michael would like to say something about the metals.
I think the answer for the metals is very much like Chris had mentioned for the E2, for the estrogens. The problem with the metals is not a big problem at all. It's more of a red herring. First of all, Victoria is not very industrialized, so the discharge of metals is minor. They also don't tend to bioaccumulate because of the way that they're sedimented out, except in the areas where there's high current, and therefore they're winnowed away and carried out into the ocean. I think the most important thing, though, in this question is that we're instituting very good source control in Victoria, and we tend to ignore that. And this is something where we really should be putting our money. Rather than trying to clean it up, which is not needing cleaning, let's make sure there's no more input.
Now, We've got a very large number of questions here, and I think what I would like to ask the organizers to do is that we should actually post these questions on the website and do our best to get some of the answers. Our panel are mostly scientists, and some of these questions are not for the scientists. Some of them are really partly for John Bobush when he wraps up, and I think I found one that Vic Derman might like to answer. Anyhow, just hold on 1 second. Here's one. If the money is not put on the table up front, the CRD will have to borrow the money to pay the contractors. What are the limits to this borrowing? And I'll ask Vic if he'll answer that in a minute. Another one was, will the current expenditures on sewage be eligible for the seniors' tax deferral program? I think the answer to that is probably not, because I don't know whether you've noticed, but most of the municipalities are now putting the cost of this sewage treatment onto their utility bill. So the amount you're paying for CRD sewage is related to the amount of water that you use in your house. Why not contact San Diego and ask how they appeal this, the EPA? Why not show on TV so more Victorians could be informed? Why not have San Diego check out our system? There is a possibility that might be happening. What are the next steps to take in trying to stop this project? I'll give that one to John Bobush. Do you propose to get your message put to the average person in the areas involved as soon as possible? Sewage treatment plants create many objectionable odors. Is your aim to push for a referendum? I can comment on that myself. The thing about the referendum is that the government changed the act, which said that the liquid waste management plan does not have to have the assent of the voters. They actually put an extra clause in, probably especially for the CRD. What can be done if the politicians, the media, and spin doctors, vested interests, just continue to ignore the facts and press on? What can we do that is most effective? Should developing areas of the CRD pilot and experiment with small area sewage treatment, Victoria treatment, as it is? Enough talk, what do we do? Action. If we change the decision to move land-based treatment, will the funding from the BC government and the federal government be available in the future? Should land-based treatment be required? That's a good question. I don't know that anybody will know the answer to that. Can't read that one. If the land-based treatment plant must go through, can the treatment plant be at Albert Head with piping going under from Macaulay and Clover Points? A friend, acquaintance, told me this summer that as a boater, when out in Juan de Fuca Strait, there is a large amount of sewage waste evident in the ocean. Is this true? Is it from the US? Anybody want to answer that one?
I'm just stealing the microphone to make a different point, and that is that I think, David Anderson, you mentioned that runoff and storm loss and what we also call submarine discharge doesn't mean our submarines, which are also a failure. I'm talking about groundwater discharge that you don't see. It's not like rivers flowing in, but they also carry contaminants. They're nearshore contaminants, and they are often the things that you notice. So when you're walking along the beach and you smell that trimethylamine and dimethyl sulfide, right? The smells of the ocean, when you come to the ocean, you go, ah, I'm at the ocean. Those are the decaying bacteria and algae that are making those compounds, and they're not the sewage that you would be thinking it is.
Thank you very much, Michael. Now, I should try and find a question for somebody who hasn't.
There was a question that you just breezed through. May I address it?
Sure.
Well, why not get this issue on television? We at ARREST probably can't get that done. We need pressure from you. Start phoning the media, the radio stations, television stations, and start hounding them that you want this broadcast. That's the way to do it. Thank you.
Explain that what I'm recording here will be broadcast on Shaw Cable TV4 in about 2 weeks down the road on Sunday at 8:30 p.m. So just watch a program called Pacific.ca and you will see this meeting being broadcast on Shaw TV.
Here's a question for any panel member. What will be the impact of the planned land-based sewage treatment plants on families living in the core municipalities? That's Victoria, Esquimalt, Saanich, Oak Bay, Colwood, Viewall, and Langford. Anybody want to comment on that one?
That's a sociological question.
Maybe I'll say something, Sean. I think
if families are forced to spend money for this, they will be very reluctant to be presented with a bill in a few years' time for things that really might improve the marine environment. Even if that was only $10 a year on the bill or something like that. I mean, this is one of the tragedies, as David mentioned, that if money goes on this, it's not available for other things. In fact, the BC Washington Marine Science Panel was mentioned earlier on, and the chair of that was Andrea Copping from the University of Washington. And some years later, Andrea Copping and I wrote a letter to the Times columnists, which they fortunately published, saying we'd like to see a non-sewage treatment tax in Victoria, where we, in order to meet this fairness requisite that the Americans want to foist on us, and Calgarians maybe too, we would like to have be paying money, but have that money, maybe a fraction of the present cost that's proposed, but have that money taken and used not for sewage treatment, but for things that genuinely would improve the health of the marine environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Now, I think this one has been partly answered, but given that our aging population may be taking more prescription drugs than these, than have not been, and that these drugs may have or not been assimilated, how can we be sure that this residue flushed through our existing sewage system is not harmful to the marine environment? I think you really partly answered that one, didn't you? Do you want to add any further comment?
Yeah, I think we've said enough, probably. The things to worry about are things that are really persistent. Right now, these things become so dilute that they're not a problem while they slowly degrade. The things that are a problem, the things that persist for hundreds of years maybe, like PCBs, which are being banned for decades, and the fire retardants, the PBDs, which have recently been banned, will continue to accumulate for a while and build up in marine mammals. But that banning some of those persistent things is the only way to go. The other things seem not to be a problem because they become really dilute and then degrade.
Thank you. Here's a question which I don't think we'll get the answer, but is it truly not all about P3s and huge profit to a company, for companies that will disappear as soon as the profit is gone? I'll just leave that one with you.
Question.
Yeah, but I don't know that anybody here can answer it. Maybe Vic would comment on that in a moment. Should developing areas of the CRD pilot and experiment with small new models of treatment, leaving Victoria treatment as it is? Enough talk. What do we do? Is your aim to push for a referendum? I've answered that one. What can be done if the politicians, the media, and spin doctors, yes, I've answered that too. What can we do that is most effective? How do you propose to get your message out? All right, we've had that. Why not contact San Diego? We've had that one. I think I've really run through a lot of these questions, which I think we could give to our scientists. But I know there was one that we thought up, which I think David Anderson answered. The question was, has not the current treatment plan been mandated? Does the CRD have a choice? And I think you, David Anderson, referred to that in his talk, but do you want to enlarge on that one at all?
I think you really covered that bit.
It has been mandated by the provincial government by letter, and the federal regulations have come out, and the federal regulations say everything south of a line in Canada, half of Canada, southern half of Canada, shall have treatment. It's the one size fits all. But there are provisions for exceptions. And in San Diego, they went to the courts, and the United States federal court, with an imaginative judge, said it would be absurd to waste, in that case, I think it was $1.6 billion, on a proposal that will do nothing for the environment. And I refuse to find that the Congress of the United States is doing absurd things. They are reasonable, intelligent people. Now, whether or not this judge was removed for this obvious matter, I don't know. But the point was that the absurdity of this, this one-size-fits-all, was recognized. And the oceanographers and marine biologists at Scripps were there as witnesses, just as we have expert witnesses. But the difference is, here, our witnesses are not getting a hearing. They're just being ignored. And I really don't know why, I mean, with due deference, the people from UVic here can put their hands over their ears in case they feel, in case they feel I'm flattering them. But I simply do not know why an institution with the excellent reputation of UVic is considered to be a second-rate high school in perhaps West Virginia by the provincial government and the CRD. They just pay no attention to the best minds we have, the best trained people we have. I'm not saying they're right. I'm a politician. I don't know. But I am saying you can at least set up a system for evaluating their views and having them in turn do the peer review for the SeaTac report, which is so often quoted as calling for treatment. In fact, I don't think the SeaTac report does call for treatment, the way I read it. And if it does, they're well outside their mandate, because they talk about it in terms of, well, in the future, the public will demand treatment, and that's not exactly a scientific statement. So I think that, I just find that it's really important that people have to go to the CRD meetings, they have to go to the committee meetings, they have to go to the by-election that we're having in Victoria soon, they have to go to the nominating meetings of the candidates of all parties, and stick the questions to them. Say, you know, this makes no sense. Are you going to say, are you going to represent us making no sense, or are you going to represent us making sense? I don't know what the answer will be. Anyway, I would say we have an opportunity for the next 6 months, at least until the provincial election early next year, of having a lot of public meetings where this issue is raised, and it's clearly an issue of importance. Wasting $1 billion that could be used for so many good purposes just isn't acceptable, and we should make that so obvious that people like Vic, Vic Dermott here have a lot of support instead of just Bev Desjardins and Alderman Hall, with really there are only three in the CRD that are standing up and asking the intelligent questions. And may I congratulate Vic on a remarkable job, because it must be a very discouraging job that he's doing.
Well, thank you very much. We're getting near closing time.
I must say something about this. This was brought about by reference to the federal regulations, and this is used as such a red herring. I, as you could imagine, have read this over very carefully. I have looked through it visually. I have used my computer to look for words, and I can tell you without a doubt that within the federal regulations that we are all being said we have to go by, it does not mention the word treatment, it does not mention the word secondary anywhere in the document. There are five restrictions that we have to do. Four of these, I won't go into them, but four of these we can meet within 10 meters, I am sure, of the pipeline. All we have to do is get the government to agree to an initial dilution zone. Whether it's 10 meters, 20 meters, 50 meters, 100 is something the scientists can determine. But we have to have the initial dilution zone before we can even make any headway on this thing. The other one, which I've already talked about, is we have to change rainbow trout for marine species. the thing is, we are not requiring the federal government to make wholesale changes in the regulations. We only have to have two things changed. Change the fish, accept the initial dilution zone. If they do those two things, we're free and clear.
Well, thank you, Joe. I'm going to take two more questions, then I'm going to invite Vic Derman to say a word, and then John Bergbusch is going to wrap up. And by that, it'll be about 9:30 by then. There's two late questions just come in. They're very much sound-based, so I want to ask them. What is the risk to the orca whales, which are heavily contaminated? Anybody want to take that one?
The best person to speak to that is actually Peter Ross, who's at the Institute of Ocean Sciences, or may no longer be there because of the cutbacks and the elimination of all the toxic laboratories out at the Institute of Ocean Sciences. So the federal chance to even monitor and explore these things is being shut down, which is, I think, just a scandal. But the quick answer is I've actually been doing part of my research looking at contamination within orcas and including things like grizzly bears. And we don't see the issues that we have, for example, with the very nearshore problems. So these offshore problems won't manifest themselves in the orcas.
Thanks very much. And here's another science one. Because the marine-based system relies on natural processes, freshwater rivers, microorganisms, how will this system deal with climate change, which may affect sea life, and Victoria's population growth? Do you want to read it again?
Yeah.
Because the marine-based system relies on natural processes, freshwater rivers, microorganisms, how will this system deal with climate change, which may affect sea life, and Victoria's population growth?
Well, I think one of the things about climate change that's already beginning to be noticed in the Strait of Georgia and the whole Salish Sea is that some of the oxygen levels of the incoming water are declining, and that will affect marine life. It will affect things in much more seriously, perhaps, than a little bit of extra organic material that's being added. Maybe other people want to add to that, but population growth, yeah, the question is how many people can be handled by the present system? And I think someone said earlier, maybe you, Sean, that the studies haven't been done. I think we could make rough estimates that we're at present nowhere near the carrying capacity of the present natural system.
Thanks very much. Well, Vera's going to...
Models propose that with the climate change here in Victoria, we'll have greater, can you hear me? You'll have greater precipitation during the, I mean, just maybe sometimes winters, right? And drier summers. So what it means we should take care rather of our stormwater discharges, because in this case, we'll have more fresh water coming into the stormwater. And if this stormwater is contaminated by any nutrients, that would be an issue. In the area of proximity of the sewage treatment plants and where the current discharges are, it shouldn't affect marine life at all.
Thank you very much. We're very honored that Vic Derman is here. Vic is a member of the CRD's Liquid Waste Management Committee and the CRD board and an elective councillor from Saanich. And Vic has asked many critical questions in meetings that I've attended, and he asked whether he could make a few comments, and so here you are, Vic.
Thank you very much, Sean, and I appreciate the opportunity. And thank you to members of the panel for pointing out that Not all CRD elected officials are one group. For 6 years, I've been questioning the proposed project, criticizing it, and voting against it. And I must say also, Mayor Desjardins and Esquimalt and Mayor Hill from View Royal have been doing much the same thing. But that's only three out of a committee of 14. We really need to get more public awareness. You know, the problems with this have been around for 6 years. I've met with ministers, I've been on television, I've been on the radio numerous times, in the newspapers, but I think until it starts to bite people on the backside, not much is going to happen. I hope it will happen. I hope that you will talk to others, and word of mouth can do a lot. I can answer the question about what will happen to families. Well, what will happen to families is that you will see an increase in your taxes of somewhere between $200 and $1,000 by 2016, just for that project alone. You know, we get concerns when we raise taxes by $75. This could be, in some cases, a tax increase of easily of $500. And that's just for this project. That's just capital. That doesn't take into account the fact that about $15 million a year loss for operating that also is going to have to be absorbed. What that means to a politician, as some people have mentioned, is the things that we won't be able to do. If we hit taxpayers with that kind of increase, we're not going to be able to hit them again. I mean, I wouldn't want to, and we wouldn't be able to. That means things like LRT, which arguably could provide much greater benefit, will probably be put off for decades. Replacement of existing infrastructure that's old and decaying. Homelessness, affordable housing. There simply won't be the money to address those things. And that is huge. You know, one of the things hasn't been mentioned in the federal regulation. I think Dr. Peck mentioned that if we are considered high risk, we must comply with regulations by 2020. If we are judged to be medium risk, we have till 2030 to comply. If we were judged to be of low risk, then we have till 2040 to comply. So one of the things I would really like to see people do, and I don't think I'm going to be able to get the CRD to do it, but somebody to challenge the federal government on how we could possibly be classified as high risk. We aren't. We're low risk. If we're classified low risk, we are looking at a period of 30 years to comply, and an awful lot can happen in 30 years. And one of the things that will probably happen is we will move to treatment. And the reason why is something called microbial fuel cells. They are a fuel cell that uses sewage as a fuel and uses microbes to transfer the sewage directly into electricity. They've been developing for a number of years now. This summer, a research group in Oregon discovered a way to get from 10 to 50 times the amount of electricity of the fuel cell. They hope to go to pilot this year or early next year. It could be commercially applicable within 5 years. That would mean that sewage, in fact, could become a very high net generator of electricity and energy. Then it makes sense. The unfortunate thing is, this thing that we are putting in, which I think is a complete white elephant, quite likely will also be completely obsolete immediately or fairly shortly after it is complete. So I wish you well, and I hope you you tell everybody about your concerns and you speak to as many people as possible. Thank you very much, Dr. Peck.
Now it's my great pleasure to introduce John Burgwish, who is the chair of ARES, and I just want to mention that John was a councillor in Colwood from 85 to 93. He was the mayor there from 93 to 99. He was a regional director of the CRD from 93 to 99. He was chair of the Water Supply Commission. He was on the Wandafuca Recreational Commission. the Victoria Regional Transit Commission, BC Columbia Transit Commission, Board of Governors, Royal Roads University, Board of Directors, Pacific Family Services, etc. And anyhow, we're very happy to have John as our chairman because he is also an extremely experienced politician, and you get the last word tonight.
Well, thank you, Dr. Peck. The first thing I'd like to do is have you all join me in thanking our presenters, Dr. Vera Paspalova, Michael Whitaker, Jack Littlepage, Chris Garrett, and David Anderson, and John Peck for hosting the evening, and to Brian for his presentation as well. So please join with me in a presentation. And I would like to thank you all for coming. Wastewater treatment is hardly the most glamorous topic with which to spend an evening. But advocating on behalf of the marine, land, and air environments is so important these days that spending an evening discussing how we deal with our waste streams is, in fact, an evening well spent. A REST campaign for a clean and green wastewater treatment system will be successful if enough people get involved. If you are convinced, as we are, that Greater Victoria needs to make the wastewater treatment decision based on science and the environment, and not on politics and public relations, then please, please, please get involved. If you haven't already, sign the petition. Direct your friends and neighbors and your family to our Arrest and Stop the Bad Plan websites and get them to sign the petition. Join Arrest. Become a volunteer. Make a donation. Some of you have tonight. We thank you very much for that. But running a campaign costs money, and though some of us have given some already, one will give, continue to give. You know, there's a limit to how much one person can do. If you're on Twitter and Facebook, spread the word. Facebook is a magic way to get people involved. In the next few weeks, Arrest is planning to hold neighborhood meetings along the proposed pipeline routes from Clover Point to McLaughlin, and then inland from McLaughlin Point to the Heartland landfill. We'll also make every effort to meet again with the seven municipal councils involved in the land-based project. And some of them will listen to us, but I can figure on at least two that will be hard to get into. So whatever you can do to talk to your local municipal councillors, to your local MLAs, and to your MP would be very helpful in helping put the pressure on to get the message out. You know, Judy Braunhoff, our CRE director, has dismissed opposition to the plans. You've heard the phrase already tonight, the train has left the station. Well, we're going to do everything we can to counter that kind of sentiment, because we believe that Ms. Braunhoff's sewage treatment train is headed straight for a train wreck. And we don't want that train wreck, because it's going to cost us a lot of money. So help us avoid the train wreck and all the millions that will be wasted. Help us help you make grassroots democracy work in Greater Victoria. Help us help you make the right decision on wastewater treatment. Help us help you to work for our environment and for a better sewage treatment plan. It's been said before, but it bears repeating. Victoria already has the finest and most effective sewage treatment system in North America. Let's retain it and save $1 billion in the bargain. Thanks very much. Please drive home safely.